Okay, we're back with another video. Another pull session today. The last one you saw on the channel was biased into lat work on the front end. Today we're biasing into upper back work. But before we do that, we're starting the way we always do with single arm cable pull downs, or more aptly put, the Glof pull downs. So I'm gonna start here. From there, we're gonna go into a upper back dumbbell row, and then we'll get into the rest of the session. So I'll take you through it as we go. Don't forget to drop any questions or comments down below. I'll be happy to answer them. Like and subscribe, and let's get into it. Just because the jumps on the stack might be too high is not an excuse not to make progress. Boom. Maybe. Boom. Fuck me. All right, so quick tip when you're trying to maintain tension through your lat, whether you're working overhead, whether you're rowing, one thing we want to prevent from happening is allowing our scaps to move excessively into upward rotation, into bro traction. An easy way to get around that or to prevent that from happening is by simply just looking at our grip orientation. Often when we think of lat, we think of a pure neutral grip. The issue that can sometimes pose is that it's very easy to slightly pronate that grip, and you can already see if something's pulling on me and I let that pronate, my scap's gonna go with it, which we don't want. So an easy cue to help maintain that scap down, keep that shoulder down out of our ear, is to move slightly past neutral into a slightly supinated grip. That's gonna work overhead. It's gonna hold true when you're rowing as well. And really all that's going to do is convince us, without us realizing it, to externally rotate at our shoulder, which is really what we wanna have happening. So sometimes it's easy things to think about. All I'm thinking about, or all I might be cueing a client, is to move slightly into supination, and then that's gonna fix all the rest without them having to think about 10 different cues through the movement. So something to keep in mind. Oh. All right, moving into upper back work now with bilateral dumbbell rows with no external support. Notice here the way I'm biasing my upper back is I'm not pulling with my elbows in close to my side. I'm not going fully pronated either. I'm gonna be semi-neutral, but what I'm trying to do as I row is I'm focusing on driving my elbows out as if I'm trying to pull those dumbbells apart from each other. And that's also gonna have my elbows traveling up a little bit, which is going to inherently bias my upper back versus bringing in something like my lat. So watch that as I go, and two sets here. First set 8-10, second set will be a little bit more than that with a little bit less weight, and let's see how she goes. Thanks, brother. Gotta love the iron. Secrets in iron grip. Wraps are not always enough, apparently.
Yep.
When we're trying to bias our upper back, we want to take into account what all the musculature through our upper back is actually doing, which largely is moving our scaps from a position of protraction to a position of retraction and downward rotation. In other words, for us to best challenge our upper backs, what we essentially want to do is move our scaps through as great of a range as possible into protraction and then out of that into retraction. And we want to do that around as fixed of a spine or as fixed of a rib cage as possible because our scaps wrap around our rib cage. So if our rib cage, in other words, our torsos are rocking, it's not really indicative of much movement happening in our scaps. So we want to keep our torso as fixed as possible, whether that's being able to brace when you're in a bent over position, or if you're using something like a chest supported row to facilitate maintaining a relatively constant torso angle, and then allowing the scaps to move around it. Another trick you can do, and this credit where it's due goes to Coach Baxter, is as you move into that stretch position, as you move into protraction, what you can actually do is take a breath in. And as you take a breath in, almost imagine that you're packing that into your upper back, because you can use that air to posteriorly expand your ribcage and create even more distance between your scaps. Or in other words, create even more of a stretch, get you even further into protraction, which is only going to be a bigger challenge on everything involved in getting those scaps back into retraction. So keep that in mind, fixed torso angle, and as much movement through your scaps as possible whenever you're trying to bias your upper back. And that goes for rowing, that goes for pull downs, through the whole spectrum of movements for your upper back. Next up, we're moving to the prime upright seated row once this gentleman has done his last set. Again, we're biasing upper back here. Reason I have this in right after the dumbbells, even though it's challenging more or less the same pattern, is that my ability to express my entire range of output when I'm relying so much on internal support is going to be handicapped to a degree. There's gonna be a ceiling on it just because of my ability to maintain position is gonna prevent that from happening. So now I move to something with external support, which is going to put me in a position to then get that bit of output that I missed over there out to fully tax my upper back. Okay. Three, two, okay. Oh, thank you. Bam. 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 So when it comes to training, we often talk about all the nuances involved. We often get deep into the weeds, which is good. It's fun to do and it's important to. However, it's easy to get lost in that and forget some of the basics. One being effort, and two just being something as simple as focus. If you watch me move through any movement I'm doing, you'll notice that if you look at my eye line, I fixate on one thing and I don't let my eyes wander. And really, I'm not even looking at what I'm looking at. I'm kind of just getting lost in it and letting my mind focus on the goal at hand, which is completing that whatever set I'm doing to the best of my abilities. A good way to think about this is think about our brains and our bodies as a whole as sort of like a computer, and not a brand new computer. One of those computers where if you give it too many inputs, it's going to start slowing down and lagging on its abilities to perform whatever task you're asking it to do. We're very much the same. We can only process so many inputs at once. So if I'm trying to do a set and milk my output for all it's worth, but my eyes are wandering and I'm noticing this dude over here doing this, that girl over there doing that, it's going to take away from my ability to really focus and hone in on what it is that I'm doing. So you want to keep in mind when you're in the gym, if you're coming to work and you're working hard and you're in the middle of a set or you're about to unrack something, focus on your eye line. It often starts there. Fixate on one thing. Let yourself put the blinders on and just focus on the goal at hand. Ooh, that catches up too fast. Okay, so moving into lat work now on the same piece, but you'll notice my setup changes. So instead of sitting in the seat as I was for my upper back rows, I'm now actually standing just over that seat and staggering my stance. Big reason for that is now working with one arm at a time, I have to start thinking about how I'm going to resist the rotational force of the load only pulling me on one side. So you'll notice what I'm doing is I'm bracing with the same side leg forward to give me a counter force directly to that load in the direction that is pulling me. So the load is going to pull me forward. I'm pressing with my leg, dropping my hips, and pushing myself back to counter that. I'm then taking my non-working side hand, I'm basing that into the seat. Now I'm kind of creating sort of a triangle that's completed with my opposite side leg, which is gonna be behind me mostly for balance. That way, I can better resist that rotational force as the load's pulling on me. Another thing I wanna do is think about what I can do muscularly to help prevent that as well, other than just relying on the external support. So what I'm doing is I'm crunching down my working side oblique to sort of lock that in as well, and then work from there. One rep up for 6 weeks into health phase now, I'll take it. So if you're wondering why I'm continuing to use this almost empty bottle of liquid chalk, if I can get any out, it's because this piece has these rock climbing handles, which make it nearly impossible to wrap a strap around, and I hate them. So I'm taking all the grip I can get, that's the liquid chalk. Huh?
back.
Working overhead now, still for the upper back. The same concept that I mentioned before applies. So I'm trying to maintain my torso angle as fixed as possible. And then again, letting that load dictated by the cable pull me into as much of a stretch, into as much scapular protraction overhead as possible. And then as I initiate my pull down, I'm thinking the exact opposite of that. Trying to create distance between my ears and my shoulders, trying to pull my scaps down into retraction, and then repeat. Moving on to accessory work now, starting with dumbbell laterals. You'll notice that I'm doing them with a pause in the top. Any lateral with a dumbbell is inherently going to bias the shortened, meaning it's gonna be hardest up here. What I'm doing with that pause is doubling down on that challenge in the shortened position, because as far as the accessory work goes, my shoulders are the most fresh they're gonna be right now. Then following this, we'll go to the cable and we'll bias the lengthened, because then I'm gonna be a little bit more fatigued. But for now, starting with dumbbells, something you wanna think about with these, and a mistake I see a lot of people making, is as you're lifting the dumbbells, instead of thinking up, which often leads to the shoulder shrugging up to the ear and the elbow bending, just focus on driving those dumbbells out as if you're trying to touch the wall on either side of you, or as if you're trying to throw the dumbbells to your side. They're going to have to come up because that's the way your arm tracks. But focusing on driving it out is likely going to keep that shoulder down and keep your arm relatively straight, which is what you want. Onwards. I feel like I'm in Harry Potter. The never-ending bag. So as I mentioned over there, what we're doing with these cable laterals now is biasing loading into the lengthened position. And the way I'm doing that is I've set that cable cam up at a height that cable is going to run perpendicular to my arm in the starting position. Whenever that's the case, that's where the load's going to be the heaviest when you're working with the cable. So that load is going to be the heaviest down here at my side, which is the lengthened position, as opposed to up here in the finish position, as was the case with the dumbbells. So now we've flipped it, because we tend to have output, we tend to have strength in the lengthened position last, i.e. we tend to be strongest, the longest in the lengthened position, which is why I'm doing this now, later in the session. That being the case, I'm also not going to try and throw it out of that. I'm initiating slow, because I know that there's gonna be a drop off in load as I move into the shortened. Single arm preacher curls. Notice I'm not setting up square with my torso. I don't have the greatest mobility into external rotation at my shoulder. So for me to set up straight, to get my shoulder and my elbow and my wrist to line up with a supinated grip, it doesn't really work. That's about as close as I'm gonna get. So to compensate for that, what I'm gonna do, so I'm gonna externally rotate my entire torso so that I can better line that up to create a straight line between my shoulder, my elbow, and my wrist or my palm that's gonna be attached to the unit. So when I'm curling in a straight line and not tweaking at my elbow joint. Okay, let's put that in here. All right, back work done, accessory work done. Now just finishing up with calves. Calves, the weakness of mine, something I need to bring up, so it's something I touch on either at the beginning or the end of every session, and the beginning and the end of leg day. So I'm hitting it multiple times throughout the week because smaller muscle groups, they recover faster, they can take a beating more frequently. So we're gonna see my calves every time that I step into the gym. That said though, that brings us to the end of the session. I might've mentioned, but I'm about 6 weeks into this health phase, about 4 weeks into the deficit, about 8 pounds down on body weight and still feeling pretty good. I'm pretty happy despite everything being pulled out, obviously being in a health phase, back to being natty on TRT. I've managed to more or less continue progress for the most part, and that was the case today as well. So hope you enjoyed the session. If you have any questions, don't forget to drop them below. I'll be happy to answer. And otherwise, don't forget to like, don't forget to subscribe, share it if you feel the need, and I appreciate you watching. If you made it this far, thank you, and we'll see you next time.